You know, our guest this afternoon is no stranger to controversy or being proved right eventually, and he's certainly stirred things up with his latest investigative reporting, which is featured in his new book, The Killing of Osama Bin Laden. Seymour Hersh's reputation as an extraordinary muckraker began with his 1969 account of U.S. Army atrocities in the Vietnamese village of My Lai. Since then, he's exposed some of the most consequential and controversial stories of the past half century, from hush money paid to the Watergate burglars during the Nixon era, to abuse of Iraqi prisoners held by U.S. forces at Abu Ghraib prison during the Bush era. Since starting out with the Associated Press, Sy has worked for a good part of his career for two leading journalistic publications, the New York Times, which he joined in 1972, and the New Yorker Magazine, for which he became a regular contributor in 1993. His journalism and publishing awards include the Pulitzer Prize, five George Polk Awards, which I think is a record, two National Magazine Awards, and more than a dozen other prizes for investigative reporting. Last year, Sy made headlines again with an article published in the London Review of Books, calling into question the official story of how U.S. authorities discovered Bin Laden was living in a compound in Abbottabad, Pakistan, and was killed in 2011. Sy's account is the centerpiece of his new book, which includes three other pieces on the war in Syria, challenging what's been previously reported by others about aspects of U.S. and Turkish involvement in that conflict. As columnist and pundit Mark Plotkin told the Washington Post last year in a profile of Sy, Sy's success as a reporter is all the more remarkable because he's not exactly the world's most charming individual. Mark, wait a minute. This turns out all right. Mark describes Sy's manner as the quote South Side belligerent Chicago in your face approach. How does he get people to tell him things? Mark was quoted as wondering. He's not a seducer, yet he gets people to reveal things that are deeply secretive. I should note that Sy's reporting, especially about the Bin Laden killing, has been greeted with a lot of skepticism and been widely dismissed as implausible and too thinly sourced. Then again, given Sy's track record, it's difficult to ignore the stuff he reports. Or as Bob Woodward has put it, never underestimate Sy Hersh. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Seymour Hersh.
That was actually accurate. He must have been a journalist. Mark is, we play tennis, Plotkin, and I can't stand slicers. That's what it's about. He's a slicer, you know. But that's a pretty funny thing to say, I guess. Ha ha ha. Let's just do a little journalism 101 here, because something in the New York Times today really caught my attention. We can talk about, I'll pimp out my book, but we can do that later. Today was a piece in the New York Times Sunday Magazine by Rhodes, Ben Rhodes, the advisor to the president. And it's pretty much, it sort of has the classic, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the problem we have in journalism. And one of it is the basic hostility of the government to us, too. Even if they think they can handle us, they hate us for being so malleable. And if we're not malleable, they hate us, period. So it's sort of a, but this piece sort of has, it has all the stuff in the world. It's by a freelance writer named David Samuels, who I think once did something on me, but he was writing for the New York Magazine then. But I have no history with him. So it's a piece of, Ben Rhodes is the deputy national security advisor to the president. As such, I've always, and the things I know about government from the people I know on the inside, and I do know, you know, there are a lot of people in the American government it's not all about always about personal ambition. There are people who take the oath of office to the Constitution, and they mean it, not to the president, but to the Constitution. Those are my people, I'd like to think. Anyway, So the piece is, this guy's going to do a profile of Ben Rhodes, who's tooting his horn, sort of, as you'll read. I'll just give you a couple of excerpts. There's a method in this madness I'm doing. About the fourth graph, he's described the boy wonder, and the White House is now 38, et cetera, et cetera. There's a picture of his darling baby daughter, so you know what's going on. He's paying the price of entry. And so, and he quotes people in the White House. Most of the stories, a story like this is full of quotes from peers and people who work with him, not people who might have serious policy disagreements, but that's the way it works. That's normal stuff. And he's quotes somebody has said, he describes himself, everybody I spoke to about Rhodes said the word mind meld. He and Obama are so close together. He's been writing his speeches, sort of amazing. He's 38. And his previous history was he worked as a speechwriter for Hamilton, the former member of the House, who's Lee Hamilton, who was then working at the Woodrow Wilson Institute, not when he was in office. Hamilton's one of the great men. Let's talk about somebody with a loyalty to the Constitution. But anyway, he confessed, this is the phrase, I don't know anymore where I begin and where Obama ends. I would suggest Obama might know, but that's okay. Anyway, so he's describing it all, and he's telling about how he can handle the press. And he developed a healthy contempt for the American foreign policy establishment, including editors and reporters at the New York Times, the Washington Post, the New Yorker, and elsewhere, who first applauded the Iraqi war and then sought to put all the blame on Bush, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And he goes on to talk about, I'm just going to go through this quickly. He says about how he can handle them. He can do it with tweets. He's got a certain bunch of columnists and reporters on the string that when there's a problem, he can send tweets in his name, and that'll give the reporters guidance, and it always works. All the newspapers, he's going on. Sort of amazingly, all the newspapers used to have foreign bureaus, he said. Now they don't. They call us to explain to them what's happening in Moscow and Cairo. Most of the outlets are reporting what happened on world events from Washington. The average reporter we talk to is 27 years old, and only reporting experience consists of being around political campaigns. That's the sea change. They literally know nothing. And he said, some people think spinning our narratives would, is a sign of American weakness. He said, I think it's the next line is marvelous. In fact, it's a sign of strength, the writer says, chuckling, he writes. He chuckled as he talked to him. I give him some color. These guys are in the dot-com business, and we put stuff. Anyway, it goes on and on and on. All right, why is that driving me nuts? Because, first of all, it's another just fawning. It's about a reporter complaining about people getting access to be and that getting manipulated. And of course, the guy writing it is exactly prototype of it. It's like Kissinger used to say. I spent a lot of time on Henry Kissinger at one point in my life, 4 years, and write a book about him way back in the dark ages. And Kissinger was the guy who wiretapped, we all know, 16 of either his aides or journalists. And when he discovered that people were wiretapping him, he always went nuts. And sort of, anyway, so there we go. He then long discussion of how we sold the Iranian deal, and we sold the Iranian deal when we finally stopped demanding that the only way we'll discuss enrichment is if the Iranians absolutely stopped enriching first. Once we told them about 3 years ago they can continue to enrich for peaceful purposes, we're going to trust the International Atomic Energy Agency to monitor it. That's when the deal was made. Nothing else is about it. Anyway, it just goes on. Drove me nuts this morning because it's sort of a real problem we have. It's this notion. He described. Oh, I got to tell you this. There's one other thing. He describes a Panetta, Leon Panetta, who I always liked when he was working in the Clinton White House, and he was a lot of fun and a good guy. But he was head of the CIA and is enough of a product of a different culture to give honest answers to what he understands to be questions of consequence. Well, okay. But I'll also tell you something about working at the CIA. One of the first things you learn, I had an old friend. There's a Middle East sort of community among the CIA. There's a family that's very prominent in there. This fellow had married into this family. They were all station chiefs for years, for generations, in all over the Middle East. And the arrogance of the CIA guys, there's a bright guy. Nothing wrong with him. Smart, but and a very competent officer. But we now know that one of the reasons the 9/11 guys work so well, and we don't know I don't want to get into some conspiracy theory, but I'll bet, I'd say my youngest son, but his mother's here, so I won't say that. I'll bet something that it was more in Hamburg, and there's a lot of empirical basis. We tracked a lot of money going to Hamburg before 9/11, more than to some cave where Bin Laden was hanging out. Anyway, it doesn't matter, but it's an open question. And we now know that the guys weren't great. The guys who did it, the 19 guys, about 10 days after, there was a panic at first. Are these guys all over? Are there 10 teams like this? Are they going to strike L.A. tomorrow? And there was a total panic for days and a calm down. And somebody smart on the inside said to me, you know what? It turns out these 19 guys who were going, they weren't very sophisticated. The only one who really was Ahmad Atta, who had a degree in mechanical engineering. And he was out of Hamburg. Anyway, somebody said they were like a pickup basketball team that got to the Final Four. You know, because we missed it. And it was on us. And you know that the CIA had two of them and looked at him and didn't report it to anybody. Well, the NSA had three. We had five of the 19. We knew, we heard them talking, and all that stuff. And so the FBI and the CIA just don't work together. And I was seeing, and about 6 months after 9/11, I'm having lunch on Route 123, you know, above the CIA with a bunch of guys. And we reporters do that, but there was a lot of people that we have some information. If you're a reporter, it's not perfectly rational. It was always, I'm you know, older and crankier than Bernie, but in the 60s and 70s at the New York Times, particularly at the New York Times, when you go abroad, you knew who the station chief was. He's undercover. You have lunch with him because you're talking to foreign leaders and you're sharing stuff. That sort of diminished, which is a big mistake, I think, by everybody. But anyway, so after 9/11, 6 months afterwards, my friend, his name was David, was going on and on about, FBI, you know, we don't do anything with them. And I said to him, this is how naive I was. This is in 2001, maybe 6 months, early 2002. I said, what's wrong with you guys? You know, what the hell is wrong with you guys? You know, after 9/11, you're still pissing all over the FBI. He said, hey, Hersh, don't you get it? He said, they catch bank robbers and we rob banks. And that always stuck in my craw. The job is, just reading a new memoir that was just published by a young man who was doing stuff in Syria. He was in Afghanistan. It was a memoir within the last, what was his, I read it, but I don't remember the name of the guy. He was an agent. And at one critical point in the memoir, he's describing the troubles he has lying about what he does to his girlfriends. What is it? Yeah, is that it? I don't know. A guy named Farr wrote one. He was an interrogator. But this is the other one. And he's describing in the middle he's describing his trouble lying, you know, he has trouble with his girlfriend. And the guy at the CIA who handles him said, are you kidding? That's your job. You've got to be able to lie. And, you know, you've got to be able to do it. That's the job. Interesting. Okay, I like it. But I like it because it taught me something I didn't know. And so, as much as I like Leon Panetta, when Leon Panetta's in the CIA, he's got a different role than he does as chief of staff or deputy chief of staff in the White House. That's just the reality. And, okay. So, we have this incredible cynicism. This is what struck me. So, about... was it in August of 2013, right? We know that the story breaks that Bashar Assad has dropped nerve sarin on his own people in an area outside of a suburban area, really called East Ghouta of Damascus, which is a really hardline holdout of the hardliners against them, the rebels, and he killed 1,400 people. And so, what I know. What I knew that is beginning, I'm going to be careful about this, in April and May and June, the administration of that same year was going nuts over all the reporting we were getting that the components that you need to make up nerve agent, it's just an organophosphate and an alcohol, but together like a witch's brew in Macbeth, it's just something else. And if you don't know what you're doing, you can kill everybody around you, which often happens. But we knew that stuff was coming in over the border from Lebanon, from the Saudis, who, by the way, are still supporting the so-called moderates, which I would make the argument do not exist anymore, haven't existed for years, just in our fantasy. It's not only me. I can tell that's sort of the argument was the JCS. As some of you know, I've written a lot about the Joint Chiefs under General Dempsey, who retired as chairman last fall. And we'll talk about him in a second. He was very instrumental. We would not be doing some of the things they're doing now if he's still chairman in Iraq and Syria. But in any case, there was a lot of reporting about stuff coming in across the border from Turkey, something called the Gendarmerie, which is a sort of a special heightened police force that the Turkish government's gone crazy. They're just murdering people like crazy. The PKK are being slaughtered by the Gendarmerie outside of the newspaper sites. And then, as you know, Erdogan has been, his prime minister, who was up his butt all the time, has quit, and he's throwing reporters in jail. He's become a real total sort of despot, and really very much still supporting the opposition, ISIS. And he's just sort of, I don't know why we don't bother to call, drop the dime on the guy. We don't. But anyway, it was so bad. There was so much stuff that so many poison gases. We knew we were in the possession of al-Nusra. ISIS was just getting underway, but other jihadist Salafist groups, the more extreme radical Sunni radical groups, there was so much concern that a major study was done that summer. It was commissioned by the Joint Chiefs about what would it take if we wanted to get rid of all the potential damage that these groups could use. What would it take? How many people would it take? And the JCS all-source study, 60,000, maybe 70,000. And so that was impossible. That's what was roiling around when all of a sudden, in August, bam, he's hit. We get the Syria attack. And the first thing we know right away, within days, the United States says 1,400 were killed. If one is killed, it's a tragedy. Nerve gas is terrible stuff. But the actual numbers were much less. What they did was, they looked at photos that had showed up online, iPhone photos of dead people. The provenance of each of those photos wasn't necessarily clear, but let's assume that they all were from people dying or suffering from nerve agent. And what the CIA did is they took some of these body counts in that limited area, extrapolated how big the whole area, the area of East Ghouta was, and came up with the number 1,400. All the numbers were much reduced. 15, still, as I say, one is too many. I'm not using the word only here because one is too many. But it's all sort of a propaganda game. And my only concern was, I'm looking at it. I'm a reporter. I was a police reporter. I'm saying, well, hold on. We got a crime here. And we're only looking at one suspect, Bashar Assad, when we know the other side has it. And so that was strange to me. Why don't you acknowledge I have documents. So what I did was, I was then working, we have fact checkers, for a lot of reasons, I think, stemming why I didn't publish at the New York. I would just say that it was always easier for me, even at the New York Times, to write about Nixon and Kissinger and than it was about a Democrat. And I think that's probably true now. It was much easier to write about Bush and Cheney than it was for a lot of people to write about Obama. And as far as I know, the New Yorker wasn't called the Seymour Hersh Weekly. So I give the editors the right to decide what they want to publish. So I was publishing in the London Review, but with the same, which is, as you may know, very, very strong magazine, very, very tough, very intellectual. And with the caveat that the people who had been my fact checkers when I was at the New Yorker all those years, many of those people, fact checking world, they move on, they write novels, but they hired the very best of them to be my fact checkers. So we did a lot of work. So this is stuff from a fact checker. So I write a story saying, whoa, you know, why, you know, Bashar, we don't have any evidence he did it. And more than that, we had some evidence. We had evidence right away, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs did, from his counterpart in England, that the first draft of the sarin we got had no relationship to the sarin in the arsenal of Syria. The Syrian arsenal was much more sophisticated stuff with additives. As I say, you meld two things, but you add things for toxicity, to make it more easy to handle. This is just sort of inside chemical stuff. Anyway, but that, and that's something he told the president, but it didn't matter. The story went, and it's been going on and on. And so when I was writing about it, I actually did get some of the cables, early cables, that were all source. They were very sensitive. They came off a system, if some of you know, in the inside Solus, the solar system, Sigon Online. And so I say that because I eventually, and I have these documents, and I also knew from contacts I had that there was a tremendous concern in the community about El Nusra and others having this crap and the damage it could be. And so there's a lot of worry about it. And the why, so we did a story, and the fact checker, the initial fact checker for the London Review, talks to the national security a spokesman, a woman named Bernadette Meehan. She was a Foreign Service officer. I'm sure she's just doing what she's told to do. And so the first go-around was, there's no such document like that. What are you talking about? We said we have specific documents showing that the concern was really enormous. And it wasn't just us. It was the Israelis who work with us a lot, particularly in Syria. Israel has a lot of reason to worry about Syria. It's a country next to it, even though I guarantee they'd rather have Bashar Assad over ISIS in that country, or El Nusra. But we also had other allies, and it was NSA, CIA, agent stuff. It was an all-source document that went to a very key guy in the government, very highly classified, and they kept on saying it didn't exist. So I did something I haven't done. I don't do it anymore. It's a game, and it's a game that has nothing to do with journalism. And it exhibits sort of, it's the same kind of contempt that I found in this article, that it was so explicit by the number, a key advisor on foreign policy to the president. Clearly, this is a view that's not unpopular in the White House, or one that he's not going to get in trouble for saying. So I convinced one of my friends to give me a lot of the serial numbers. Anybody been inside the government, you know, when you get to sensitive stuff, there's a lot of... there's a lot of ways you can track a document. If anybody's ever seen anything from 10 Downing, it's full of all sorts of dashes and you have to go into foreign languages almost to get the line right. So I then gave this through our fact checker. We gave this Meehan, I think 12 or 13 of the 16 digits on the document, and the response was really fascinating. It came back. I went to my office today to find it. Off the record, well, again, off the record is not unilateral. It's by joint. You can't just say off the record. You have to say, can we go off the record? You know, but the White House just says off the record, and that's the way everybody so bows and scrapes to that. Now, this is the answer. She gets all these digits. No one is saying that the memo is not a physical thing that exists. What we are saying is that... that the facts you allege it contains are incorrect, which is probably why no one has seen it. It most likely did not go forward because it was wrong. And so we're now at a level of discourse that's just insane if you're trying to be a serious journalist. So there's a discord, there's a disconnect in our profession that's profound. I'm talking about the people that really care and try and do it right. There's a contempt for us. Maybe we deserve it, all of us. It's a contempt that goes two ways. It's a contempt for people like me that bark and yell. It's a contempt for people that go along. It's a sort of amazing thing. I've never seen it spelled out so clearly. So having said that, we'll go back. I'm just saying that because, you know, it's so demeaning to my profession, a story like that, somebody talking that way about us. Anyway, my concern is this, in case you care, about the story of sarin. I just go nuts. A couple of weeks ago, Jeff Goldberg, who's really a nice guy, and I've known him a long time, and I like him, did a long piece on Obama, got access to Obama, on him in The Atlantic. I'm sure you read about it, because he was on. He did a lot of publicity. He was on television a lot about it. And he writes, he starts off the story by saying, why didn't Obama, he had promised that if Syria used nerve gas against his people or attacked them again, there was an allegation they had before, unproven, like all this stuff is. The UN has never said a word about who did what. The story began. Why didn't he do it? And why didn't he bomb, like he said he would if they used nerve gas? And so he's writing that story. Jeff writes about, and he says they killed 1,400. In the middle of the story, it's a long story, 20,000 words. In the middle of it, he just says cold, clearly from the president. He said, well, one of the things was that the head of intelligence, General Clapper, an Air Force general, who runs the office of, he's director of the Office of National Intelligence, theoretically the top dog in this archive, in this sort of listing of, the CIA's under him. General Clapper told the president it's not a slam dunk, which on the, if you remember, that was the phrase that the former CIA chief Tenet, George Tenet, said to Bush before he attacked Baghdad. A completely crazy statement, given that there was never a bomb there and the threat that that Bashar Assad didn't have nuclear weapons. And it's a code word. It means we don't have a boss. We don't have it. And it was the same thing. I'd written a piece for the London Review called, I don't know what it was called. It was about General Dempsey. And Martin Dempsey, here's the thing about Martin Dempsey. He majored in English at West Point. I think he was a legacy, so he had to go, you know, a family thing. He majored in English, and afterwards he did the Army is great. They gave him 2 years. He got a master's degree in fine arts at Duke. He was fascinated by Yeats and became sort of an amateur Yeats scholar. And in his contacts over the 30-year career, he became personally friendly with, and by the 80s, by just everything, the orbits were the same. By 2012 and 13, when he was chairman of the Joint Chiefs, Sir Peter Wall was head of somebody he'd served with 20 years ago, was head of the British military, and a Russian general that he'd served with, against even the other side in West Germany and East Germany, but they used to meet at social events when the wall was crumbling. Valerie, I'll mangle his last name, but he's the general in charge of the Russian. He's the, sort of like the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of the Russian Army. All three were friends; they all knew each other. There was a lot of comity at the top, and so Dempsey is the one that. Dempsey did tell the president the day before the president decided not the bomb. He told him to say, I wrote a story saying he told him the same thing. He went to see him and said, we don't have a case. He said there were three things going on for the president not bombing. Everything's more complicated. One is the Brits had voted not to attack, not to join us if we bombed. The French were dying to go. French are always dying to go. And the other one was that Nancy Pelosi had told him she'd have to have hearings if he did bomb. And General Dempsey also said, if I have to testify, I'll say the truth. Dempsey, by the way, retired August 31st and September 1st. He had an appointment at Duke. He's now teaching a bunch of courses at Duke. We don't have chairmen of the Joint Chiefs that go off to teach instead of getting on 50 boards and making $600,000 a year from each or something like that, some exaggeration like that. But if you look at it, it's sort of an interesting guy. Okay. Obama, he's gone. The new guy is much more hawky, General Dumford. And so we have things like the president announces a couple weeks ago that he's going to put 250 special forces guys into Syria across the border. And there's some criticism about, are we getting into another war? I mean, how are we doing in the wars right now? How's the wars going? The one in Afghanistan, how are we doing there? Everything okay? I don't think so. We don't change course. I always think this way about it. Let's see. They hated Russians, but the fact is Russia's always been close to Syria, and they were invited in. And if you remember, Putin said, I'm going to bomb. He began the bomb. We screamed, and the president said it's going to be a quagmire, a lot of schadenfreude. He's going to say it's going to be in there forever. He's not going to get out. And after 6 months, he did pull out. No question. He turned the corner. Bashar Assad is going to stay, whether we like him or don't like him. He's a much hated figure in this country. I don't think you can get two votes for him in the Senate and House on anything. You can get anything passed against him. There's only a couple of guys in the House that will not. go along. So he's a hated person, but the fact is, he's going to run the country. And the fact is, you may be able to do something with him after an election or something, but he's holding on. He's not going anywhere. So he invites the Russians in. The Iranians are in, and he invites them in. Hezbollah's in, the Shia force from Lebanon, Nasrallah's force. They're in. They're very tough fighters. They're in, but they're all invited. So we put 250 people in there. The president puts them in, says, I'm going to put 250 people there. It's a sort of in your eye to Putin, because the only way you can resupply him is by air. And Russia controls the air. They have radar systems. They control the air. They can shoot down anything in that country. And he knows that Russia will not do it. So it's sort of, you know, sort of a one-upmanship thing. And so I always think this way. Would the President of the United States, without invitation, put 250 people into Israel or Canada? No. And why? It's just so easy for him to do it and say it. Well, the criticisms are valid criticism, but it's never that one. And you might get a sense of why we may not be so liked in the world. It's just sort of like there's a rule for us, and it has nothing to do with the law of war or what you will. It's sort of like we can just do what we want because we are. So anyway, I had an introduction to this book. The articles here are just stuff I wrote for the London Review that a lot of people haven't seen here. And I got to tell you, I was in Europe. I was in London talking about this for a couple of weeks. And overseas, what a shock. There's much more skepticism about America than there is here, much more openness. So I'm going to read you a little bit about it. I'm way over already, aren't I?
If you want to take some questions.
Let me just read about a meeting. Let me just tell you about a meeting. Some of you may remember David Ovey. David Ovey was the chairman. He was he left the Congress after 32 years. He was a Wisconsin legislator. He was chairman of the House Appropriations Committee. And you don't know this. He's a sort of mild-mannered, very bright, difficult sort of taciturn is one word for him. I was dealing for a long time with he was in the House Committee. The House Appropriations Committee, there's a subcommittee on military affairs. And that has, look, all the money has to go through there. And they have a special secret, it's just not known. They have an investigative unit, 12, 13-man unit, mostly people from the Office of Technology Assessment, not the intelligence, some FBI guys, mostly from civilian analysts and budget guys. And they do a lot of reviews. And Obi figured out in 2005 that Cheney et al. Was running operations and not without running a lot of operations abroad. I'm in the middle of a book on it that I don't know if I can get through the legal stuff, but okay. But he was running, he had foreign bank accounts, let's just put it that way. And he was running a lot of stuff off the books. We're talking about billions of dollars he had access to. It's a very amazing story. He's the one thing he is, Darth Vader, but he's Darth Vader with a brain, a big brain. That makes him even more dangerous, who also is committed to the notion that at any day now, some Muslim country is going to get a bomb and destroy America, which, of course, is driving force. Anyway, Murtha, there were four members of this little select committee that Obi had that got access to every briefing, everything the CIA did. He had to be told about it, every finding. It was Murtha, a Democrat from Pennsylvania, who died a couple of years ago, Obi, a very decent guy named Flood of Florida, who went along with him, and then a creepy guy named Jerry Lewis, who ended up, if you remember the scandals with Livingston out on the West Coast, he was in the middle of all that junk. He was Cheney's guy. And the way it worked in this investigating committee, if one of the four objected, he could blackball an investigation, so they were stuck. The Democrats were stuck. They couldn't get anything going. And he went to the floor and did something. Anyway, the point of all this, he raised some issues, no press on it. And the other thing was Murtha was a pro-military guy, been in the service, and he was the guy the generals went to cry on. They cried on his shoulder. So he knew how bad that war was going in Iraq very early. He knew from talk, and he began to be very outspoken about the war. And I started seeing him on all sorts of stuff. He's dead now. Not because he saw me, but only in America, Obi and Murtha didn't talk. So Obi would sort of like to know what I was hearing. So I would go see him, and eventually we became sort of, I wouldn't say friends, because he's sort of, He's a very honorable guy, and he's very taciturn. He retired. He lives in a house. And when I have to do business with him, everything I'm going to read to you, he saw and edited and changed, and we worked it out. But his wife does his emailing. And he doesn't work for anybody. He retired, 61. He could make a lot of money as a lobbyist. He just doesn't do it. And so anyway, so he's pretty amazed. Less than 3 weeks into the administration, he's called over by the president to a meeting at the White House. This is a story he told me only after he was out of government. And as I say, I've gone back over it with him very carefully. So there's nothing here he hasn't seen. And so 3 weeks, it was February 13th, and he took office the 20th of January. This is in 2009. And there's a couple other people there, a couple of the members, Democrats. And the vice president was there. And he's saying that he's going to expand the war. He's going to do a surge in Afghanistan. He had called the war a good war. And at that time, there was a lot of talk in the press. The military generals are running around saying, we want 40,000, 80,000 more troops. No, he was talking about anywhere from 17 to 30,000. So they had this meeting. And so so here's what I wrote about him. I'll see if I can get this in a graph or two. Obi stunned his colleagues in 2010 by announcing his retirement. He and I had talked off and on during the Bush years. He would listen but say little. 6 or so months after he left Congress, he was more forthcoming. He told me about a meeting he and a few other congressional leaders had at the White House. The issue was Afghanistan, and Obama wanted to know he's going to make a significant troop commitment to the war there. And this is something we hadn't thought he was going to do. He ran on hope and peace, whatever it is. He said it was a good war as opposed to the other one, but the idea of expanding a war there, because we were, anyway. And he was going to make, he said he was being told, he quotes Obama, this is Obi quoting Obama to me. He said, this is me quoting Obi on him. He said he would expand the war and then asked all of us one by one what we thought. Joe Biden raised a bit of caution, basically about the cost. When it came to me, I said, Mr. President, and this is not a self-serving dude. This is a really, braggadocio is not his thing. I talked to him quite a bit in the last, those awful years. He once went to Cheney and Addington, his lawyer, about covert hits and crap like that, that being done with no briefing to the Congress, no authorization for the money. And they said to him, well, it's the president, this notion, if you remember, some of you follow this stuff, unitary president, this sort of neocon, I'd almost say Straussian notion of, you have this elite, Straussian's the notion of the elite leaders who, with it's okay for the elite to lie to the people, the good lie, if you will. Lenin's big problem was he should have given the people, Cheney once said this, should have given him religion. He took away religion too, should have had him religion. Anyway, so he goes to see him, and they don't dispute that the Constitution was seen in that White House as a nuisance. But they said, if you don't like it, go in federal court and sue us. And nobody's ever said that before. Go in federal court and sue on a super secret program. I mean, it's so stunning that the chairman of the House committee would be told that's his only recourse when the Constitution is also there. It's just amazing. Anyway, so it came to me. I said, Mr. President, you could have the best policy in the world, but you need to have the tools to carry it out. And the governments of Pakistan and Afghanistan are pretty lousy tools. And this is not a guy who, like everybody always tells you what he said to the president or said to his boss or said to his wife or said to his kids. And none of them, it's usually not true. But this guy, anyway, the government in Pakistan are pretty lousy tools. If you did a surge in Afghanistan, you will have to face the fact that it would crowd out large portion of your domestic program, perhaps health care. And we did know that the estimate of $1 trillion over the next, it was just, we all know that all the estimates are always way off on war. Anyway. So at the end of the meeting, he said to the president, can I see you for a second privately? And this is what really is sort of fascinating. You all remember this. He asked him if he remembered in 2003, NPR began broadcasting the Lyndon Johnson tapes of the war. So he said, at that time, I guess, was he in Congress in 03? Probably. No, 04. So he was in the house, driving around with his kids and his wife, if they had kids then in 03. So he said, He said, have you ever spent time listening to the broadcast of Lyndon Johnson's telephone conversations, in particular his discussion about expanding America's commitment to the war in South Vietnam? Johnson, this is what I'm writing, Johnson had taped more than 9,000 of his telephone calls while in office. They created a sensation in office upon their public release in 03, just as President Bush was expanding America's war in Iraq. Obama said he had. I then asked Obama if he recalled listening to the conversation with Richard Russell when they both talked about how upping the American effort in Vietnam wouldn't help. And my point was that Johnson and Russell were making a decision to go ahead when they were telling themselves privately that it would not work. And if you remember, I wrote this quickly, he was a segregationist, arch conservative, chairman of the Armed Services Committee, longtime Johnson and confidant. And I went back and found it and played it. And at one point, he's pushing Johnson to go to war. And Johnson's moaning about the Kennedys want me to do this. I know they want to do it. And at one point, Russell says to Johnson, well, I'll tell you, it'd be the most expensive adventure this country ever went into. And Johnson answered, it just makes the chills run up my back. I haven't the nerve to do it, but I don't see any way out of it. So then Obie said to me, I then said to Obama, who's your George Ball? Some of you remember George Ball was one of the guys early objected. He got chewed up by Bobby and sort of was muted. But in that first year when they were talking about the Bay of Pigs and other stuff, Ball was always against it. And also very much against Kennedy's early decisions to expand the presence in South Vietnam. So Obama did not. Obie said to me, this is on my second go around about 6 months ago. He added this, either the president chose not to answer or he didn't have an answer. But I didn't hear anyone telling the president that he ought to put the brakes on in Afghanistan. And so I just cite that because it's just so familiar. It's just so easy. The hard thing to do is to say, no, I'm not going to do it. And so when the president did in the fall, when he said he wasn't going to bomb Syria, it's because he knew, A, from two people, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs and his superior, technically, the director of the Office of National Intelligence, there were problems with the intelligence. He also knew that the chairman was going to say that if he was testifying. He also knew the Brits weren't in it. And he also knew that So what he really did is, and this is why I get sometimes mad at the press, if you really did your homework and read, you'd see that for almost 2 years, the Russians had been talking to us, Lavrov and Kerry, and later the president and Putin at a meeting 2 months earlier at the G20 summit. They've been talking about disarming. Syria wanted to get rid of these crappy weapons because they were under constant attack from the rebels. And they were, and the Russians were helping defend them. There were arsenals full of chemicals that he couldn't use. You can't use a chemical weapon in a guerrilla war or a tactical war. It's not effective. The wind changes and everybody's dead. And so what happened was, the issue was always that the issue we had with the Lavrov idea is that Syrians said we can't pay to move this stuff out and decontaminate it was estimated. It actually came to 1.2 billion, according to I brought this paper so I'd say the group right. There was a paper done on this. It was called under the Chemical Warfare Convention. There's something called, believe it or not, it's called the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, OPCW, international body for implementing such things as getting out of these weapons. It's an international group. And so what, and the Russians said, hey, we can't pay it because, you know, oil's going down because of your shale oil. We're suffering. And we were very skeptical. There was a great appeal to getting rid of it. But, we didn't want to pay all that much. And secondly, we thought, what if we agreed? This is what the internal debate was. What if we agreed and it didn't happen? We'd look like fools because we agreed about something that was peaceful. You never look good if something peaceful doesn't work. Anyway, what happened that night is he paid. And eventually a ship called the Cape May, an American ship, was taken out of mothballs, decommissioned and refitted to be a containment vessel. And everything I'm telling you now is in public documents. The Cape May was an American ship. It moved into international waters. Syria would not allow it inside its international waters. They're still technically at war with us. And I think a Danish and a Norwegian freighter, eventually 1,308 tons of junk, were moved. Junk, I'm talking about nerve agents, the precursors, the two, the chemicals and the organophosphates you need, precursors, and mustard gas, other weapons, and weapons and shells, weapons. Anyway, it was moved to the port, and these two ships then brought them out to our 1,308 tons. They were decontaminated, but what happened is we had a forensic analysis team there, and what they did is they did DNA and other testing, and we had another way of showing they weren't Bashar Assad's. It didn't mean you couldn't prove some rogue elephant, some rogue group in his army went and made some stuff up and tried to, you know, we can't prove any. All you can prove is that the stuff that was there wasn't his. And that's a lot different, because the president also doesn't, when he explains the story about what he did, he says, wasn't it good? We got a deal. We got disarmament because we didn't bomb. Well, okay. But it's more complicated than that, Mr. President, and that's what gets me. We don't pay our presidents to not tell us some of the important details that you have to, particularly in the middle of a very difficult war that's going on. You don't pay the president not to say, well, the truth is that we ended up paying, the estimates I have, I've done some of the work on this, but not enough to write it, at least $1 billion of the price, because it was our ship. Hell of a time getting that stuff unloaded. The stuff when you have 1,300 tons and you decontaminate it, it's with hot water and a certain acid, and it creates sort of like a Drano stuff, but it's 15 times that the mass. So you're going to dump this somewhere. I don't know how we missed the story. They tried to dump it. First of all, they had to end up going to a mafia port in Italy to get it unloaded. And then they put it on other ships, and nobody wanted it. There were 10,000 people rioting in Crete, and even in Cyprus, huge riots about where to dump the stuff. We missed it all. It's just more complicated. And that's what I like about, you know, what I want to do. It's just more complicated. What the hell was he doing 3 weeks into when he did this? And I know this. When he was talking to Obi about expanding the war, there had not been one yet systematic study. And when you talk about expanding a war, you're talking about maybe, it turned out 30,000 troops went. How are you going to move them? How are you going to supply them? How much water will they need? When they land, what order will they land? How much toilet paper do you need per day for each guy? 22 pieces or what? How much water? I'm serious. It's called the tip fiddle. There's a list of things you have to do. He just was winging it, but he wanted to go early. And I just don't think we fully understand him. I don't, because as my oldest son always says, he's going to probably be the brightest president we're going to have for the next 50 years. And so, you know, I don't understand what is there in our psyche that makes the president think the solution is always more and more arms and arms. What do we have? What's the fault line here? And that's what interests me. And that's why, you know, I'm not going to change anything. But I can tell you that in almost every story that I look at, there's always another side. And it doesn't get written often, and it's hard to do it. You know, in the Bin Laden story, you know, if you want to believe that the ISA, which is one of the most lethal, potent intelligence services in the world, really nasty bunch of guys, if you don't think they knew where Bin Laden was all the time, I mean, I just can't figure out why it's so difficult to get some people to start thinking about some of the things that happened. But anyway. I don't want to dwell on that because I do all the time. Let's do questions before it starts raining.
So if you have a question, would you make your way to that microphone, please, or that microphone?
We'll do 15, 20 minutes. You can all go, you know, to Mother's Day dinners and whatever. Go ahead. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, my question is on the 28 pages, and you were just saying Obama is so intelligent and aware, and I agree. So the 28 pages, what do you think the relevance is? Do you think there's something in there? And also, is it possible, because it's reported that Obama hasn't even read the 28 pages?
You want an honest answer?
Yes.
How in the hell do I know? How do I know what he thinks of? What's in his mind? I have my own little thing. My own little thing is that when we all watch cable news now, MSNBC or Fox or CNN, and they have all these groups of journalists and experts to come and talk about political events, what's Trump going to do tomorrow. If it took away two words, they'd all be mute. The two words are, I think. Everybody begins what they say, I think. Nobody. So the answer is, I don't know. My guess is they're not as lethal as you think. That's just a dumb guess. Because look, the Saudis in the Bin Laden case, They got him early. They got him in six. They kept it from us for 6 years, for 4 years. We only learned about it when somebody walks in and told, looking for a $25 million reward, an unhappy Pakistani, a colonel, maybe didn't make general or whatever. He goes in and he talks to our station chief, a smart guy named John Banks. And he tells Banks, we've had him for 4 years. And we start checking. First, the big thing is, and the underlying thing about that story that makes, for me, makes this story so interesting, or compelling, or frightening, is what's the big issue with us in Pakistan? They are now running two reactors. They've been running one since the 80s called Kahuta, and against our objections, they started, that was a uranium enrichment. This one is a plutonium one. And we are in a total panic, along with the Israelis and the Indians and others, about their bomb. They have, when I wrote about it in 09, they had over 100. And we don't know if they're telling us the truth. We like to think we have comedy with them. We give the generals, the leading generals of the Army and the intelligence service there, you want a helicopter, you got a helicopter. One guy was a golfer, you want to go play with Jack Nicklaus in Columbus, Ohio, we can fix that up for you. We did all that stuff. We take care of these guys. And then to find out, the double cross is why the Saudis paid them. They went to the Saudis first, Bin Laden's a Saudi. And presumably you have to assume that maybe the Saudis didn't want us getting to Bin Laden. That's an assumption that's worth making. It's enough of an assumption so they felt they could double cross us. But then again, in South Asia, it's, you know, they can look you in the eye and not tell you the truth more than we're better. They're better at that than we are. I don't mean to be racist about it, but it's just the way it is, that there's always a self-serving motive. So you start looking at things. And by the way, to show you how dumb I am, in the article I wrote, I knew it was going to be holy hell for me when I write a piece that's saying that what happened with Bin Laden wasn't quite the way the president did authorize him, and he did kill him, and that should have been great. And he wasn't supposed to announce it for a week. We were going to protect the Pakistanis. A significant percentage of that country is full of very serious jihadists and Muslim supporters who adore Bin Laden. He's probably, if he had listed the most popular guy across the country, he'd be number one. You know, if you included everybody. And we're always worried about the Muslim influence on the nuclear arsenal. And so anyway, what I did is I mentioned Bank early in the piece. He was the guy, the walk-in. And Bank had been mentioned in an internecine dispute, but he hadn't really been mentioned. He's a good guy. He was a Harvard grad. And everybody told me he was really bright and competent. And I figured, okay, here's the play. If they really want to walk all over me, and I thought, this is what I thought when I published the story, get Bank to come out and go on CNN and say, walk-in? I don't think about a walk-in. What's Hersh talking about? I'm a dead goose. I didn't think he would. And I thought the fact that he didn't do it, and they sent out some retired guy named Morrell who wrote a book that was attacked 53 pages by the Senate Intelligence Committee, over 70 lies in the book. This is the guy they sent out, but they know nobody reads. They know we don't read. So they won that one. But anyway, the point is, I thought this is a real dog that wouldn't bark. And somebody would say, you know, if Banks isn't out there, but I was so wrong, nobody cared. Even all those years I've been there, I guessed wrong. So, you know, anyway, go on.
Hi. You mentioned...
Oh, okay, I'll go there. Sorry. Yes, ma'am.
Two very quick questions. One relates to the Nobel Peace Prize and the fact that Obama received it, given the type of behavior that you're describing.
Nobody knew it.
Okay. Then that would be
the dimension I was looking for. The way he played out, he had the generals talking, McChrystal and others talking about 40, 80,000. And when we gave an increase, it seemed like it was tucked in and he was sort of a reluctant warrior. I always wonder why he didn't yell in the first few months of his presidency, these generals are going around making speeches, we need 40,000. I always wonder why Obama, that's a president's call. I wonder why he didn't tell that guy to shut up. But that was the political, I don't know that. My assumption was it gave him some cover.
And the second relates to tweets. More and more leaders, major governmental figures tweet instead of provide some background and all that. As a brilliant reporter like yourself, what are you doing with this material? Why tweets, and what do you actually build them into your narrative, or how do you think that this is faring for reporting in the future?
I have three children who have told me absolutely categorically, A, I do not read Twitter and I don't tweet. So there, I'm safe. I don't have to read that. Here's the classic story about Twitter. It's Farseal, but you're drinking. You're at the old Ebbett. And it's 3 o'clock in the morning or 2 o'clock when it closes. You're a little drunk and you're walking across. You used to be able right past the White House. Now there's a wall up, but you're walking. Lafayette Park is at the park. And you go, and it's 3 o'clock on a Sunday morning, you see a bunch of lights out in the third floor of the executive office building. So you tweet, lights on in the third floor of the executive office building. Before you're long, what's going on? Big crisis. Some guy's mopping the floor. So that's the problem with it. So there's the problem with it. But having said that, with the demise of newspapers that we're having, you know, and it's coming. They're not, you know, I don't know if they all be online. This whole new world we're seeing of blogs, you know, it's just like 20 years ago, the big worry was, oh my God, Johnny doesn't write. You know, Johnny doesn't read and write. And then comes email. Johnny's reading and writing like crazy. And faster than we can. And so I think that we're going to be all right. And the media is going to be all right. It's going to be a whole new art form. And it's just sort of inchoate now. It's just, you know, it's child's play right now. They jump on things. But you're seeing some of the web pages are more interesting. I read a lot of them because there's a lot of good stuff in some of them. And it's more alive. And I'm not big on people's journalism. I mean, I think you have the professionals, but I think it's going to be okay. I think we're going to be okay in this new market. But tweeting is, I'm so happy not to miss it. Yes.
You mentioned Turkey's Erdogan and his jailing of journalists, silencing of critics, and support to ISIS. Will you or have you yet begun investigating and documenting what's really going on behind the scenes? And looking ahead, what is the other side of the story?
What do you mean the other side?
About what's going on in Turkey right now that one day we'll see after he's destroyed the press.
I'm sick and tired of the Kemalists, you know, the old military guys. For years they've been telling our intelligence community, he's dead next week, we're going to get him. They don't do it because, you know, the military, you know, they did coups. They did depose leaders, the Kemalists. They're a very tough group in Syria. They don't like them. But the problem is that Turkey. There's a lot of prosperity. Istanbul's become a great place for tourism. There are more people are making money. The army doesn't have the juice it did. They're terrified. They're afraid if they knock them off, they'd fall. They'd be the suffering. So I don't think there's any. As long as the president of the United States continues to think that he's okay, that, you know, that was the first place he visited overseas. He went to Canada early, but the first overseas trip over the water was to Turkey, and he praised Erdogan. At that time, Erdogan was a model sort of. Rational sort of Muslim secularist. He'd even gone to Syria a year or two earlier in 2006 or 7, gave a very big speech there talking about the need to be, you can have religion, you can exercise your religion, but you must run your government in a secular way. And then he just moved on and on. The only thing, I can give you speculation, he survived a very serious illness. And he does think, you know, I think he does want to put himself back in running the Ottoman Empire. That's the only guess we have. We can't understand him anymore. But the White House hasn't pulled a dime on the guy yet.
So do you see this now, given the way he's gone after journalists and the press?
He's been doing it for years.
Yeah.
What's your question? Yeah. You think something's going to happen?
Well, now that he's
Why do you ask those questions? Because most people don't give a rat's ass about Turkey.
Because I work on an emergency assistance program for journalists at risk, so we follow. Yeah, and they're constantly
at risk. That's. Yeah. I mean, yeah. They're way beyond at risk.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, they're in the dungeon.
Yeah,
it's just amazing what they get away with.
Yeah,
and this is an ally. Mm-hmm. All right, we'll do a couple more because I the last train leaves or something like that for New York. Go ahead, over there. Yes, sir.
The Post had an article recently that the CIA station chief in Pakistan thought he had been poisoned.
Yeah, right.
What's your thought on that?
Well, I mean, if every newspaper published long stories about what people think happened to them, if you don't think the ISI could kill him in 1 minute, that's my reaction to it, basically. I think it has to do. There's a lot of sensitivity about the stuff I write, this stuff in particular in the White House. And that's so I'm just telling you, there's a lot of sensitivity about it. I don't want to be too self-serving here, but there just is. And I also get inside. I do get inside. And and so that story, there's a lot. Pakistan is still angry. What happened was, the game was, there was not, all the stuff about couriers was just a made-up game, and it made sense. By the way, in the CIA, there's something they call eyewash, and there was a story in the Washington Post, you lie to your peers in the CIA, if you have to. And it's one of the things you do. If you got a bunch of people chasing couriers, and you have a walk-in, And you don't want to say how you know where Bin Laden was. It's great to let the couriers think they did it. And then they're very convincing, and when they see the press and all that stuff, that's normal tradecraft, protecting the source. That's what you, you know, that's what you're taught to do. You protect the source. And so when I start writing about it, that causes some concern. And the real deal was, because the Pakistanis had stood us up, and we were so angry at them for that. That was a betrayal, because we do all the stuff for them. Why? So we can have access to the bomb when we want it. And the fear we have is that there's, we know there's hundreds of bombs and igloos and salt domes and stuff, and we try and track where they are. But the fear is, as somebody once said to me, sort of very prettily, is, are there some bombs out of the count in the tall grass along the runway that we can't see and we don't know about? And then we're in trouble if that's true. We don't want Pakistan to think it can retaliate to something without us jumping in. That's all. That's what we want to do. We want control. And this, I wrote a story in 09 for the New Yorker, for David. And, you know, yes, we disagree on policies, right? But, you know, he is what he is. He's an editor, and I like him. And we just disagree. So I go, you know, I don't have to marry every editor. I'm a freelance writer. I can, you know, I used to nastily, I can do what I want. I don't have to marry every editor I sleep with, is the way I was going to say. Well, that's just the way it is. Anyway, I grew up with editors who disagreed with me and stuff. Abe Rosenthal at the New York Times, when I was writing all this stuff about Vietnam and Watergate, he used to come and go like this, sneak up behind me and say, rub my hair and say, how's my little commie today? But then he would say in the next sentence, what do you have for me? And it was Tony Lewis, myself, Gloria Emerson, a guy named Richard Eater. We were the cell, because we kept on saying, Viet Cong is a lousy word. They're Vietnamese nationalists. They're not communists. And you know, and when the war ended, the nationalists, the National Liberation Front, Ho Chi Minh, that's the first group he went after. He said, because they're not really loyal to us. They're just guys who killed the Americans for us and with us, but they're not really communists. And so we were trying to get that across. Anyway, I forgot what I was talking about. So let's go on.
Mr. Hersh, yes, I recall the sarin attack in 2013.
Right.
And how the Secretary of State emphatically said that, oh, we know that Assad did it and everything. And when it happened, I also remember that Obama had talked about a red line.
Right.
And all of it became, it was very suspiciously, the timing is very suspicious to me from the beginning. And then I read later on a book of Robert Gates, his memoir.
Right. Very interesting. Yeah.
2007 or so. That the Israelis hit a facility
right.
in Syria.
Right, alleged nuclear reactor.
Yeah, and Gates talks, he said that the administration at this time, I don't know if he's telling the truth, said
no,
that
it's a pretty,
they
pretty honest
that
book.
It was a false flag attack, a false flag operation to draw us into a war in Syria. Could the Israelis have also been involved in this alleged,
No?
Why not?
Because the Israelis were working very closely with us with monitoring what happened. What happened was, if you think about it, just think about it this way. One of the things that was interesting is that about 3 days before that raid, a group of UN inspectors arrived, United Nations inspectors, into Syria, and they were staying downtown in Damascus. And Bashar gave them authority. There had been previous incidents of alleged gas use up north near Aleppo. And Bashar agreed that they could go in, they would be taken and delivered to the hands of rebel units. I'm telling you, everything is a reality. And go and from the rebel point of view, investigate an incident, and then come back and look at it from the government point of view. So he did agree to that. And so then the idea was right away, geez, team of 12, a dozen guys come into the Four Seasons in Damascus to start doing it. And 3 days later, he's going to authorize a hit of sarin. I mean, there was a smell test. And the fact of the matter is, at this point, there's been a bunch of UN papers. Nobody's ever said one word as to who did what. And I'm going to tell you that if there was anything empirical, we would have said it. Why wouldn't we? We've been saying everything we can about it.
Because we protect Israel like we protect Saudi Arabia. I mean, that's my point.
Well, I think I don't think it's. I think we certainly go a long way to protect him. I don't think it's quite like Saudi Arabia. Israel doesn't, you know, and they take money instead of giving us beans and oil. But that's a, but that's you got a point. A lot of people have a right to believe that. Yes, sir. Okay. Okay, yeah. I'll just do
Hi,
you.
Very quick.
And we can talk. You can come up afterwards. I'll be sitting here.
Sorry, very quick. I just want to thank you for your being the thorn in the side of power and for your gift of intellectual curiosity. And on that note, why there's an absence of collectively referring to several times you've mentioned about the kind of what's going on with America, that there isn't a challenge to this. Two, if you have the listening of ear of anyone close to the President
Obama. Was that first thing a question?
Yeah. Are we living? I mean, I'd like to see Obama's daughter go off to war during her gap year.
Oh, well, that's not fair, actually.
Well, it is, because it's easy to send her children to war.
Well, I mean, you're entitled to think that, but I wouldn't want to send anybody to war. That's the answer.
Well, I know. I know you know what I mean.
So what's your question?
The question is, are we not living a retake on Gladio, post-World War II operation that took place throughout Europe in smoke and mirrors of this entire thing of obsession and approach towards this, as opposed to just pulling out for cheap
somewhere
oil in the Middle East?
I know somewhere in there you have a question. So
are you familiar with Gladio?
Oh God, I do remember it was a big covert operation, but I don't remember anything about it particularly. I don't remember.
Yeah, it was where the U.S. intelligence, along with the British intelligence, blamed left wingers throughout Europe, when in fact they were hired thugs by the right, the fascists, and they hooked into the former Nazis' intelligentsia throughout Western Europe. And when I think of what just happened up in Brussels, so I think these kind of things need to be connected. I welcome everyone to research the history of Gladio.
Okay. We should go, right? And I'll anybody with a question, come up here and we'll do it. Let me just do one more. She's been waiting. Go ahead, shoot. Go ahead. I don't care. We'll do it.
I was intrigued that you were suspicious, wary, dismissive of people's journalism. Is it because...
No, it's quite the opposite. I said that in the long run, it's going to be great.
I thought you were kind of saying that, of course...
It's in Kuwait right now, mm-hmm. You know, because the example I gave, two people walking by and looking at something, but it's the future.
Okay.
And it's going to get better.
All right, good.
So I'm not dismissive. All right. Come up, we'll do the questions. Bye.
Oh my God, Kelly.